Finally tonight, an African nation struggles to build democracy after civil war. From Liberia, we have a report from special correspondent Kira Kay.
In a suburb of Liberia's capital, Monrovia, the crowd swell to catch a glimpse of their country's president, Ellen Johnson Sirleaf.
The president!
Officially, she's come out to dedicate a public latrine. But this is election season. And so every move Sirleaf makes is also political. In 2005, she became the first president to be elected in Liberia after decades of coups and civil war. She's now running for a second term, one of 16 candidates in a competitive race.
It's been for us a struggle, but let me put it this way. We've come a long way.
The first term was just tackling those fundamentals, putting in place the structures, the systems, the laws, the strategies. It's taken me longer than I had anticipated because the capacity was so low.
Liberia's two civil wars, waged between 1989 and 2003, were infamous for extreme brutality, drugged up child soldiers, and chaotic rebel factions. 250,000 people were killed, a million more displaced. By the time warlord President Charles Taylor was forced from power in 2003, the country was destroyed physically and emotionally.
The whole moral integrity of the system was undermined during these years of deprivation, during these years of war.
Sirleaf's qualifications as a former international banking executive and her standing as Africa's first female president have made her popular on the world stage and attracted billions of dollars of donor aid and debt relief.
We had an $80 million budget when we came in. That's probably a budget for one of your high schools. Our revenue has increased to enable us, so we've rebuilt the streets in the capital, which were woeful, and the main ones, and now we're starting on the primary roads. We've restored electricity in the capital city that was dark for 14 years. And today we're now adding more. There was no water, tap water, and we've restored that. We have made primary education compulsory and free.
All of this has been underwritten by the security guarantee of one of the largest United Nations missions in history. At its peak, 15,000 Blue Helmet troops and police. And at this police academy, the United Nations is training recruits to begin to take the lead on internal security.
This is a new day. This is a new development. This is a new setup of police force.
Good morning, man. Good morning,
sir. Colonel Samuel Dekana says three-quarters of the 4,000 needed officers have already graduated from these halls and are out patrolling the streets. He also admits the police have had a bad reputation as being corrupt and abusive.
It came to a time that even the citizen never had confidence in the law enforcement. But by effort of the training and officers that are now in the field performing, people begin to see it different compared to what has happened over the years.
On the other side of town, more signs of nation building.
Prosecution may not pursue the case.
This moot court, supported by the American Bar Association, is preparing the first class of magistrates to graduate in 20 years.
Guilty and nothing but guilty.
In a matter of days, they will fan out to every underserved county in the country. Trainee Calvin Kamara says the stakes couldn't be higher.
Liberians resorted to war because they never had access to justice. Some felt that their rights would be trampled upon without redress. So in order for the peace and stability of Liberia to remain, justice plays a very important role.
The magistrates program seeks to address a need even President Sirleaf admits she didn't solve during her first term. The delivery of services outside Monrovia to the rural parts of the country, where populations are at greater risk of marginalization and discontent.
The road to Liberia's capital passes through here, Bong County. This region experienced intense violence and displacement during the conflicts. Rebel warlord Charles Taylor even once had his headquarters here, recruiting fighters from among the local population.
There are a lot of youth that ex-combatants, war affected.
Jackson Speer, an analyst with International Alert, says Liberia's fragility can be seen best here, on the streets of Bong County's main town.
We have a very weak local governance structure as a result of the war. Because of that, the youth could take advantage of it and could begin any violence that they want to. We've had the case where police stations have been burned down twice since the last elections as a result of the youth being generally frustrated about things.
Liberia has a staggering 80% formal unemployment rate, and the government's job creation efforts have lagged. But a few basic skills programs have been set up for former combatants in hopes of keeping them engaged. The YMCA runs this auto mechanic class for young men like Moses, who was forced into Charles Taylor's army at the age of 9, was orphaned, and then lived on the streets.
If I think about it, I'll be feeling that kind of funny way.
Moses says he hopes he'll have a future at this, because when he's not busy working, his thoughts return to his wartime experiences. Many of Liberia's other war-affected young men have had to resort to working together as a sort of union of motorcycle taxi drivers. But analyst Jackson Speer says their wartime command structures remain in place and have sometimes led to violence.
The reason why they hold together and they're so violent is because they feel vulnerable. Just in case there is a problem, they can respond to one another through those structures. But we're not trying to transform those structures into positive gains for the community. It's also dangerous.
This past spring, several hundred Liberians fought as mercenaries in neighboring Ivory Coast's civil war, then returned home with their weapons, only some of which have been seized by the UN mission UNMIL.
We are a post-conflict nation. Even the peace that we appear to enjoy is very fragile. If UNMIL left today, who knows what's going to happen?
One of Ellen Johnson Sirleaf's presidential opponents is lawyer Charles Brumskin.
We believe that nothing we do in this country will matter if we do not reconcile.
He says the country is made more vulnerable by the absence of a formal reconciliation process.
After 14 years of war, Liberians remain divided, we remain hurt, we are angry, we need a leadership that would have the moral authority to bring our people together.
Soon after she was elected, Sirleaf did create a Truth and Reconciliation Commission that collected victim testimonies and named perpetrators for prosecution. But the final report also recommended that Sirleaf be barred from public office because of her early financial support of warlord Charles Taylor.
Had this report come forth without President Sirleaf being mentioned, by now, I bet you it would have been implemented. But because she was indicted, nothing has been done about it. Regrettably, there's not much coming from our friends, even in the international community. So we have the problem of beginning the process of reconciliation.
I've never been worried to the point where we're not implementing it because I've been named or because I've been affected. No.
There are other reasons it's moving slowly.
There's other reasons it's moving slowly. The resources that it takes, the capacity. The report is very voluminous and the recommendations are many.
Ultimately, it is the Liberian voter who will judge Sirleaf's record. During a first round of voting that set the date for the presidential elections and addressed several constitutional questions, the stage was already being set for a hotly contested race.
I feel that the country is progressing. Development is going on, infrastructure development.
School teacher Freeman Godu praised President Sirleaf's work on recovery, but is still deciding who he will vote for.
Well, my own concern would be about some form of corruption. Corruption have brought this country down to its knees. So we want government to be able to weed out the corrupt officials in government.
Corruption is a long-time problem in the country, but one that many voters feel has shown little sign of abating under Sirleaf's leadership.
The government is corrupt. They're not in favor of Liberian people. The young people, no job creation. We're going to use this card to make sure we're not going to do any, pulling here and there, but we're going to use this card to vote Madam Ellen Johnson Sirleaf out.
This election is being widely viewed as a test of the country's stability. The United Nations is waiting until after the vote to determine an end to its peacekeeping mission.
Are you post-conflict?
We are post-conflict.
Is it guaranteed that we'll remain post-conflict and we'll slip back? I cannot give that guarantee because we still have vulnerabilities. But of one thing I'm certain, the majority of Liberians, seeing what they can gain from peace, do not want to go back to war.
As Liberians head to the polls this election day, there is more at stake than Sirleaf's bid for a second term. A democratic and violence-free election will be another important step on Liberia's delicate road to recovery.